previously on the Scream retrospective, Welshy reviewed Scream 1, then got a call from someone who sounded like Thalis, but wasn't actually Thalis. Maybe. Then Rob left the room of his own free will and was sadly massacred. Then Welshy reviewed Scream 2. Now back to the Scream retrospective.
Plus, it left the door open for a sequel. And 3 years later, we got Scream 3. I'm parched. I've got to go out there. Yes.
I'm still here.
Go away. Very cheeky.
Take a little walk to the edge of town. Now spread your wings and fly. Don't the lights of the city look so damn pretty when you fly so high? It's hard to know that down below the streets bathe a swimming deep in blood. Nothing could make a grown man cry. You really wanna know what's wrong with this land? You're scratching your head with your red right hand.
Yeah, like I'm really gonna end it there. Hi, I'm Welshy, and I'm an asshole. And even though I've only been on the site, what, less than a year? Half a year, if that? I've gotta say, despite that, I am really, really pleased with my viewing figures.
Fuck you, said Panda!
Like I said, I'm an asshole. And now, we're moving on to Scream 3.
Ooh, nice.
That may seem random, but oddly, this is the only place in the video I can actually put that gag in. Scream 3, as you can probably tell, is my least favourite of the series. And there are a number of reasons for this, which I will go into. But first, a history lesson. When Scream came out, every actor who was due to survive the first film, bar Courtney Cox, had a sequel clause placed into their contract, meaning if a sequel were made, they'd all have to come back. At the conclusion of Scream 2, no one had signed such a clause, and so getting everyone back for a third film would prove to be a lot more difficult. Plus, at this point, a number of the cast's careers were doing quite well, so they may not have even wanted to return. Sadly, the only real casualty turned out to be one of the biggest, writer Kevin Williamson. With Scream and Scream 2 under his belt, along with I Know What You Did Last Summer, a small rewrite on Halloween H2O, and the success of Dawson's Creek, which were all hits by the way, Williamson decided to step up and left Scream 3 before writing it to direct his first feature film, Teaching Mrs. Tingle. Don't laugh. Williamson, while writing Scream 2, came up with the idea for 3 and left notes, which were completely ignored as the studio decided to go bigger and funnier. So, right from the off, Scream 3 was in trouble, with the man who had created this world moving on to further his career. I don't blame him for this. Everyone in Hollywood wants to get ahead. Bad pun. And so, if you're a writer-editor, you will eventually want to direct. And with Williamson gone, you'd think the studio would halt pre-production, alter the release date, disband it altogether if possible, and just wait for the director, the writer, and all the right parties to come together to plan out this story to give it the great final chapter, as it was supposed to be then, that this series deserved. You would be wrong. Instead of waiting, the studio pushed forward, hiring writer Aaron Kruger to pen Scream 3. So Scream 3, right from the off, was a bit of a mess. But I don't blame Aaron Kruger for this. I blame Dimension and the Weinsteins. If they'd simply moved the date and waited, then Williamson could have finished teaching Tingle and returned to write Scream 3, something which he stressed he wanted to do. Okay, now sure, the film could still have been a mess. But at least, the tone would have been consistent. As it was, Kruger was brought in and had to write a story in a world with characters he had not created, in a subgenre of horror that was almost exclusive, yeah, I said it, to Williamson's style of writing. And no one could have recreated that. With every horror film that had come out after Scream, people had been trying to copy the Williamson formula, and none of them were successful. Kruger was in trouble from the beginning. He didn't know the characters, which he's fully admitted, and it shows as at times it almost feels like Courtney Cox and David Arquette are doing impressions of Dewey and Gale rather than actually being Dewey and Gale. Gale being the biggest casualty, as Cox in particular seems to be playing Monica Geller but doing an impression of Gale Weathers. Gone is the hard-nosed reporter, and in her place is a Dewey-dependent screamer who follows Dewey around all the time. The only character who comes out of this film feeling close to the same character we've known over the past two movies is Nate Campbell's Sydney. In fact, the only time the film feels like a Scream film is when Sydney's on screen. But there's a problem with that too. Nate Campbell, for a long time, refused to commit to Scream 3. I was in college when all this was going on, and I can remember checking the internet fan sites daily to see reports that she still hadn't signed. Eventually, she did sign. But due to the rush to get the film out by a certain date, Nate Campbell was also filming another movie at the same time, which meant that Sydney's screen time in Scream 3 was severely cut, meaning she was only on set for 20 days. Yeah, so this meant that the main character of this whole horror franchise was hardly going to be in the final chapter. Now, to be fair, this did add some intrigue to the filming and story, as people wondered where the Sydney would finally go in this one, perhaps even be the opening victim. The trailer only added to these rumours, as she hardly appears in it. Along with Campbell's problems, there was also the question of whether Liev Schreiber would return to his role of Cotton Weary, with reports floating around that he wouldn't, and it seemed like almost the last minute before he finally committed to the film. This is also the first Scream film I was able to see in a cinema, so it does hold a special place for me in that regard. But, at the same time, I'm not blind to its flaws. The sad thing is, there's a really good film under here trying to get out, but with the switch to comedy in tone over suspense and the overuse of the Ghostface Killer, as well as the full removal from the real world of the past two films into a full-on fantasy movie world, Scream 3 not only lost its way as far as the franchise goes, but thanks to being written by a man who didn't understand the type of humour that had made Scream unique, Scream 3 became the very thing the first two had mocked. But, I stress, I don't blame Aaron Kruger for this. Long history lesson, wasn't it? Now, I know there's probably people out there, well, at least one person out there, thank you TV troops, who would have much preferred it if I'd skipped all that background info and just jumped straight into showing you the movie. But then I wouldn't have been doing anything unique, would I? As it stands, it's still a Scream film, and I can still enjoy it while pointing out its flaws. And believe me, there are a lot of flaws. And I stress this now, even though it is my least favourite of the series, and I will probably tear it apart at some point, I still enjoy it. The film opens with a shot of the Hollywood sign as we encounter Cotton Weary stuck in a traffic jam on the freeway complaining to his agent about a cameo he's just filmed in the next Stab film, Stab 3 Return to Woodsboro. Admittedly, this is a little confusing as from what Cotton's saying it sounds like he's negotiating the deal to appear, yet later we learn he's already filmed the scene. So from that, it sounds like he's filmed the scene before negotiating the deal. If I were him, I'd hire a new agent. Since the last film, Cotton has managed to use his hero status to propel him to stardom, and he's now the host of a late-night talk show, 100% Cotton. His mobile phone rings, and upon answering it, he finds a woman on the other end, who first seems to have called a wrong number, before she realises she's talking to Cotton Weary. Cotton, feeling frisky, I guess he had 5 minutes, ditches his agent and gets flirtatious with the caller.
Why don't you tell me who you are?
Ooh, you're a naughty boy, Cotton. Now what would your girlfriend say?
What makes you think I have a girlfriend? I know you do. I'm right outside her bathroom door.
And here begins one of the signs that show Scream 3 is going to become the very thing its predecessors mocked. Remember in Scream 2, during the opening cinema scene where we saw the movie version of Casey getting ready to have a shower, as that's so the cliche thing to have the victim do? Guess where we find Carlton's girlfriend? If you said the shower, congratulations, you're not an idiot. And you don't write the- What the hell was that?
Damn you, gagging order!
So that was the first sign for me that Scream 3 was actually becoming a stab film. Knowing Cotton has connections, the killer asks one question. Where is Sidney Prescott, promising to kill Cotton's girlfriend Christine, played by Kelly Rutherford, if he doesn't give the right answer?
You listen to me, you fucking psycho. You lay a finger on Christine and I swear to God I'll kill you.
Wrong answer.
No, wait. Hello?
Cotton pulls out at speed. How's that for an innuendo? To make it back to his apartment. He tries calling, but the phone line's been cut. He tries ringing the police, but the lines are busy. Back at the apartment, Christine gets ready for bed until a blast from Creed startles her. She makes her way through the apartment and turns it off, only to hear a door open.
Who is it? Who's there?
Christine? Hon, you all right? I'm home!
Ah, must be Cotton. Ghostfist charges towards Christine, who first slips, fights back, and then manages to lock herself away before hearing Cotton's voice coming from the other side of the door.
Talking about how much fun it's gonna be to rip your insides out! Now open the fucking door, Christine!
So I'll be honest, when I first saw this scene in the cinema, I wasn't really scared. I was more confused. I was just like, what the hell is going on? Cotton arrives back at the apartment and begins to move through the rooms. Jesus, that is a nice apartment. Eventually, he arrives outside the room she'd locked herself in. He knocks, calls out to her, and then proceeds to try and force the door. This is something I do like, because from Christine's point of view, Cotton doing this only makes him look more guilty in Christine's eyes. Cotton eventually forces the door, but the second he takes to steady himself, Christine bursts from the closet swinging a golf club, thinking it's been Cotton outside all along. Terrified, she refuses to turn her back on him, which means she doesn't see Ghostfist in the hallway. Cotton tries to warn her, but she swings and connects with his head, which allows Ghostfist to stab her in the back and leave her to die. Instantly, Ghostfist turns his attention to Cotton and slices his arm. Cotton tries to fight him off and pin him under a bookshelf. Succeeding for a second, Cotton reaches for the club, only for Ghostfist to slam the case into his face, sending him toppling over his desk, momentarily knocking the wind out of him, which allows Ghostfist to plunge his knife into Cotton's chest and deliver his final message.
It was a simple game, Cotton. You should have told me where Sydney was. Now, you lose.
This opening scene shows a number of the problems I have right from the off with Scream 3. Firstly, I can understand the whole making things bigger, but one of the factors that made Scream and Scream 2 scary were its locations. It's scary to think about a serial killer existing in your neighbourhood. It's scary to imagine the same thing at college. These places are filled with people who are identifiable with locations and hangouts that, again, may be very familiar to you. You may have hung out there too. Scream 3 is set in Hollywood, at a fictional studio with fictional actors. It takes that big step into the fictional world that Scream and Scream 2 managed to avoid. Another problem is that, by now, everyone is up to date on how a Scream film works. We know the first people you see will be the opening victims. As soon as I saw Cotton, I knew he was for the chop, so there was no suspense. One of the big reasons Randy's death was so effective in Scream 2 was because it happened at the halfway point and no one was expecting it. With Cotton, it's the beginning of the film. You know he's a dead man walking as soon as you see him. From the hills of Hollywood, we arrive at a mountain range in an amazingly beautiful location where we find Sydney, living in isolation, under heavy lock security as she takes up her post under the name of Laura, as a guidance counsellor working for distressed women. Next, we're reintroduced to Gail, giving a lecture on journalism as she's approached by Detective Mark Kincaid, played by Patrick Dempsey, who informs her of Cotton's death and that the killer left something at the crime scene.
This is Maureen Prescott. This is Sydney Prescott's mother.
Next, we move on to the set of Stab 3, where we meet Stab 3's director, Roman Bridger, played by Scott Foley, and horror producer, John Milton, played by Lance Hendrickson, as they deal with the negative publicity around Cotton's death.
Violence in cinema is a big deal right now, Roman. This is not the kind of news this studio's after.
So if we stop making scary movies, what, all the psychos in the world will retire? Come on.
I like this scene because you can almost imagine Wes Craven having the same argument. albeit in a far more imposing way. It's also a sign of the strains that was going on behind the scenes with the studio pressing the film to be something it didn't want to be. Moving along, we meet the cast of Stab 3. Tom Prince, played by Matt Kessler, who's playing Dewey. Angelina Tyler, played by Emily Mortimer, who's playing Sydney. Tyson Fox, played by Dean Richmond, who seems to be playing the token black guy who'll probably die halfway through. And Sarah Darling, played by Janie McCarthy, who's playing Candy. Why did I just explain all this to you? Because other than their names, these characters have no defining characteristics, and you'll probably have forgotten about them by the time I finish this sentence. Which brings me to another problem with Scream 3. One-note, expendable characters. While people could argue that Scream 1 and Scream 2 had very little in terms of character development, one thing most people can say is that, regardless of development, you could actually remember them, even if you hated them. A good example of this being the reveal of Mrs. Loomis at the conclusion of Scream 2. Laurie is hardly in the film, but you still remember her and know who she is when she appears on screen. But the characters in Scream 3? Yeah, they don't even register a blip. I'll admit though, I do like the mirror here of the scenes from previous Scream films, with the characters sitting around and talking about the victim from the opening scene. Only now, it's actors playing characters who are playing the characters from the previous movies and—
Oh no, I've gone cross-eyed.
Gail manages to get inside the studio and, setting her spy cam, gets confronted by Jennifer Jolie, played by Parker Posey, and her bodyguard Steve Stone, played by Patrick Warburton. Parker is the best addition of the new cast, which, admittedly, isn't saying much, but then the woman is so damn funny and charismatic, and has such a great rapport with Courtney Cox that it at least makes her scene somewhat enjoyable. And Parker, through sheer force of personality, makes you remember the character. Jennifer is the actress who's been playing Gail through the Stab series, so the two women already have a really complicated relationship, despite the fact they've never actually met. This is made all the more awkward when Gail discovers Dewey on set, with a little less limp than last time. Apparently, having broken up since Scream 2, Dewey and Gail share a few awkward moments as we discover Gail has rubbed a lot of people up the wrong way, including Tom Prince.
And that story that you did last month on me crashing my car? Wow, was that ever powerful journalism?
Right.
And before the broken up couple can talk further, Milton has Gail removed from the set where she meets Jay and Silent Bob. Yeah, you heard me. She meets Jay and Silent Bob. What the fuck world is this supposed to be based in again? Now I know this was done as a nod or a friendly gesture, whatever, which resulted in Craven cameoing Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back. But come on! Jay and Silent Bob are fictional characters who exist in Kevin Smith's own universe. Scream has set itself up as existing in the real world. This one scene, which I know is meant to be a gag, kind of blows all that out of the water. So, like Scream 1 and Scream 2, right now we've got all the players on the field. And, I'll be honest, other than Sydney, Gail, Dewey and Jennifer, I couldn't remember a damn thing about anyone else after this scene. We now come to the first scene in the film that really freaked a lot of people out in the audience, and was generally scary and creepy. Not surprisingly, it features Sydney. Back at Sydney's retreat, we see her having a conversation with her father, in a nice little cameo from Scream 1, as they talk about her mother and her secret life. Sydney's father wants her to come home, noting that she's almost slipping into a state of non-existence.
That's the idea. Psychos can't kill what they can't find.
Sometime later, Sydney lays asleep as the camera focuses in on the picture of Sydney and her mother, which we've seen in every Scream film. Outside, as the music begins to swell, we see a figure in white walking towards Sydney's retreat. As the camera focuses in on the picture of the face of Sydney's mother, we see the figure is in fact Maureen Prescott. She stops her approach, and when Sydney awakens, she sees this. Maureen calls out to Sydney, claiming everything Sydney touches dies and accuses her of being poisoned before falling out of view. As Sydney approaches the window, calling out to her mother, Ghostface appears and smashes through the glass, which causes Sydney to jerk awake from her dream. This scene in the cinema was freaky as hell. I can remember an audible groan going through the room, and it wasn't one of those roll-your-eyes groans. This was a general shift in uncomfortableness, and really freaked a lot of people out. It's also a really nice way of showing the imbalance Sydney's going through, especially living alone, and helps show that Sydney is still haunted by certain memories regarding her mother. Back at the Stab lot, Sarah pulls up for a meeting with Roman, only to find the office deserted, save for a jump scare from Tyson.
Well, excuse us, Sarah. Makeup test.
Tyson and Stan, the makeup man, depart, leaving Sarah alone as she waits for Roman, who was the director from the opening scene, just to remind you. While waiting, the phone rings, causing her to drop the trophy she had in her hand, which beheads it. The caller turns out to be Roman, who apologizes for running late and suggests they run through the scene while he's on his way.
What character? I'm Candy, the chick who gets killed second. I'm only in two scenes.
Again, this is a scene I do like. It's a nice play on the phone conversation kills from previous films as they run through the script of Sarah's character's Candy's own death in Stab 3. Like most conversations, though, this one takes a sudden sinister turn.
It's not just a new script, it's a new movie.
What? What movie?
My movie.
And it's called Sarah Gets Skewered Like a Fucking Pig.
Now that felt like a Ghostface remark. Understandably spooked, Sarah leaves the office and sees a shadow against the exit, so hides in a separate room. A room which just so happens to contain a whole host of Ghostface costumes. The shadow, it turns out, belongs to a security guard, and with no one around, he turns off the lights and shuts up shop. Back in the prop room, Sarah tries calling security, but, as always seems to be the case, lines are busy, and one of the Ghostface costumes comes to life. Sarah does try to fight him off, but she's surrounded by breakable props which do no real damage, allowing Ghostface to connect with a punch to the face which sends her crashing through a glass door, and a stab to the back. Switching to Dewey and Gale, we get a bit of backstory and learn that after the events of Scream 2, Gale and Dewey return to Woodsboro, where Gale nursed Dewey back to full health before becoming bored of life in a normal town and left for LA to further her career. We also learn why Dewey is actually in Hollywood.
2 months ago, the Woodsboro police got a call from a woman who said she was with Stab 3. She wanted to see the file on Sid for research.
And?
The boy said no, and she wouldn't give her name. A month later, the station gets broken into. The file room gets ransacked.
Someone stole Sid's file?
I already removed it. I think someone on the film is trying to find Sid.
This I like. It's completely in line with Dewey's character. He's one of the few people who would know where Sidney is, and being her big brother, he's on the set of Stab trying to find the people who are looking for her. I always liked this way of getting Dewey involved in the story, as it felt natural and something he would naturally do. A beat from Jennifer takes Dewey, followed by Gale, to Jennifer's house in the Hollywood Hills, where she's reeling from the death of Sarah Darling, noting that someone is killing off the actors in the same order they die in the movie. To which Jennifer informs Gale that in the Stab 3 script, Gale Weathers is the next character to die. We also learn that Dewey's trailer is located on Jennifer's property, which in a sense means he's living with Jennifer, the woman playing Gale in the movies. Yeah, that's not a little creepy, is it? Back at the murder scene, the killers left another picture of Maureen Prescott.
10 more murders and we can publish a calendar.
And we learn that while Gale was due to die in Stab 3 Third, there are 3 versions of the script, and no one knows which version the killer actually read. The police do decide to follow up on the phone call Sarah received, though, and with Stab 3 shutting down, they arrive to question Roman about the call he made to Sarah.
No, I never called her. I never told her to go anywhere.
Roman says she knows your voice.
The police take Roman in for questioning, and Kincaid borrows Dewey's mobile in order to make a call. Sometime later, we switch back to Sydney's retreat as she receives a call from a woman in distress claiming she's killed someone. As Sydney tries to calm the woman down, she realizes the call isn't coming from the works line, but the house line. Fearful, Sydney demands that the caller tell her who she is.
You know your mother's voice when you hear it? Now turn on the news!
And with a second cast member murdered, Stab 3 has been officially shut down, prompting those involved to hope and pray that these killings may be over.
Just one question. Do you think it's over, Sydney? Do you?
Sydney arms herself and scans the house, finding nothing, but takes in the realization that Ghostface has found her. Back at the Hollywood Hills, the remaining cast members are having a rap party. Tom drunk, Angelina scared, and Jennifer not really caring. Gale arrives, why I don't know, as she has no reason to be there, and spies on Dewey and Jennifer sitting in Jennifer's bedroom, in which they talk about Gale, and Dewey looks over a publicity picture of Jennifer.
This is a good picture of you. You look just like her.
Do you remember what I said earlier about Dewey living with Jennifer being creepy? I still stand by that. Stone discovers Gale outside, and Gale and Dewey slip away from the company to talk, where Gale informs Dewey that the police released Roman as the calls didn't come from his phone. The conversation slips to Maureen, and the question as to why the killer keeps leaving pictures of her at every crime scene.
How old do you think Maureen Prescott is in this picture?
1920.
That's what I thought. So I checked it out. I cannot find any information about her at this age. I mean, nothing.
But upon seeing the latest picture, Dewey makes a connection.
Look at the buildings. The second story. There and there. It's the same. It's the same street 28 years ago.
Outside Jennifer's house, Stone's doing his rounds as he gets a call from Dewey, asking him to watch Jennifer as he needs to go to the police. As Stone's a complete asshole, he ignores Dewey while helping himself to the loose change in Dewey's trailer, and then makes a really callous comment.
Hey, I'm just checking to make sure there's no killer in here waiting off you like he did your little sister.
What a prick!
What did you say? I can't believe you said that. That makes me angry!
Oh no, please, no. After a comment like that, I really hope this character doesn't die. Back inside the house, the surviving party gets slightly startled as Stone manages to stumble out of the trailer before finally succumbing to his injuries, leading to the party retreating back into the house, closing the doors, only for the power to fail, which freaks them out, so, sticking together, they all head outside. A little moment I do like here is the sound of ringing causes all of them to check their phones, before Jennifer realizes that someone is sending through a fax. I can only assume it operates on a different power setting, as the whole house is supposed to have lost its power. But then, you know, I might just be nitpicking. From the fax, the killer starts sending through script pages, announcing that he's outside and will grant mercy to just one of them. In a nice nod to the first film, Gale and Dewey call the killer's bluff and shepherd everyone outside. But Tom, being expendable cast member number 2, goes back in to read the final page. Why he doesn't get the page and then bring it out to the rest of them, I don't know. But he instead uses his lighter while in the kitchen to read the final line, which results in an explosion which decimates the entire house. And I'm not talking a little explosion. This is Bustrom's speed driving into the plane at the airport level of explosion. All this from a gas that no one could smell? Now I know a man who definitely has something to say about this.
What about that? Well, no, not really. I mean, it's entirely possible gas could work that way, but that explosion was way too excessive, I know, but there's also these variables you gotta worry about. Type of gas that was used, the source of the ignition, the size of the room, whether or not the windows were sealed off. Not to mention, there's a ton of people in that room. Just breathing in the amount of gas to cause that kind of explosion would have killed everyone in that room before they had a chance to light the lighter. Either way you look at it...
Just say the line.
Gas doesn't work that way.
Say it right.
No, I'm not your screaming bitch boy.
I'll give you corn.
GAS DOESN'T WORK THAT WAY!
Attaboy.
I fucking hate you.
The surviving cast members all leap over the balcony to escape the explosion, and after coming to a stop, Dewey chooses to follow Gale's voice instead of Jennifer's. Despite Jennifer being the one to, you know, give him a place to stay and not drop him and leave him to further her career. And just as he reaches Gale, Ghostface strikes. But Dewey manages to save Gale's life, even appearing to hit Ghostface, who collapses and rolls under the van before Dewey himself falls down the embankment. There's a few things that annoy me here about this little sequence, some of which I'll come back to later, but if anything, it's the handling of Gale's character. Like I said earlier, she's become completely Dewey-dependent. All she's doing here is standing there screaming for Dewey, which goes against the independent woman we've known from the previous films. Ghostface has vanished, and the couple almost share a kiss before Jennifer breaks up the moment and is understandably pissed about being neglected, and lets Dewey know about it.
Who gave you a place to stay? Who are you supposed to be protecting?
I love that little touch, because if you watch her, you can almost see her winding up her shot to hit him. Gale takes exception to someone else getting a punch in the face, though, and gives Jennifer one of her own. With Ghostface nowhere to be seen, suddenly Angelina appears, in shock over what just happened back at the house, before Dewey notices another picture of Maureen, only this time with a message on the back.
Take a little walk to the edge of town. Now spread your wings and fly. Don't the lights of the city look so damn pretty when you fly so high?